Welcome, Saravanan ji. Let us continue your presentation on the Tattva Bodha. You had presented till the Adhikari chapter. So now you can continue about the Atma Tattva Viveka.
Yeah. So the first chapter, basically we, just to summarize, we got introduced to why we need this book, what are we going to get with this by reading this book, and what is the qualification needed, pre-qualification needed for someone to be able to appreciate what is given in this book, right? So that's where the answer being like for liberation or moksha, getting away from samsara, which almost everyone agrees and accepts that like there is suffering in the world, and like why are we doing, what are we doing, and everything is pointing towards happiness, and if it is happiness, is that the right way, the right direction we are chasing that happiness, right? So that was that is the end goal, and the qualification being like you need to have that viveka to discriminate, being have the ability to discriminate, and once you discriminate, have the vairagya to go after the right path, right? And then understanding the nature, have the ability to control the senses and mind, and focus it on the right knowledge to reach what you want, right? So that's where we completed the first chapter, right? And this is very clear, and like everyone will appreciate why we need to know this, and like it's not about knowing it, it's about like being able to walk that path once you have set a goal, right? And from there, we move to the next chapter where we are talking about Atma Tattva Viveka. Right? So here we are being introduced to Atman. Right? So try to introduce Atman. We see that like we are introduced to concepts like what is satya, satya, mithya, what is nitya and anitya, right? Because if you have, for someone who has not come to this field or to these concepts, will not know Atman at all, right? And once you come to this field, how do you introduce something new to a student? Right, so that's where I see that we start with very simple things like let's start with what you see, right? And like there are only two things we see, like which is true, and like what is not, that it is untrue, right? And like the untrue is very easy, we call it asatya, right? And what we see there, the new concept is introduced. Okay, there is, so what you see is, I agree that you experience it, but then right there, like the author introduces satya and mithya, right? And when we go to satya, the simplest way to define is like whatever you see, it is as is, doesn't change at any point of time, right? And it, which basically means it existed always, right? So that like it is always true, right? And anything that is with respect to a place or a time, right? Right. So that is not, that cannot be satya. And then to describe the next thing about the world, hey, I see it. Right? Why is it not true? Right? there the concept of mithya is introduced, wherein like it is, you cannot, the nature is like it is always changing, right? And so you cannot hang on to it, because what you saw at one point of time is already gone, right? And so to introduce that to the concept of mithya, we are talked about, like we are introduced to our senses, like how effective are our senses, right? What are you using to actually see this, the instrument that is our senses, the eyes and ears, and that, and which feed the information to the mind, and mind is the one that presents what is the data that is collected from these senses to the brain, which is what we actually see, right? So you want to go to the next slide? Yeah, right. So when it comes to the senses, we are the easiest way to explain is like, do you believe all the things that you see, right? It looks like that, but then like the examples, like take the example of sun rising, right? If you just look at sun rising, it looks like we are in our place, the sun is rising, but on inquiry you understand that the sun is always at the same place while the planet is moving around it, right? Same way, like look at the blue color of the sky, right? It looks blue, but then like it's not because it's colored blue, right? There is a different reason why it's showing up like that. And same way, the mirage, right? The way it looks like there is water, but when you go there, it's not there. So the senses have their limitations. So it's up to the person to ensure that, like, how deeply to rely on the senses, right? You need to have that knowledge to use that instrument. That's what we are going towards. And then even when we get, it is actually being compiled by the mind and it's being fed. And as a result, the same scenario, when it is seen by multiple people, actually it is presented in a very different way to each one of them. And that is based on the coloring of the mind, the conditioning of the mind, the conditioning of the person based on their community. And that is that is why we see all the differences in the world, and which is leading to all the problems, people fighting, right? Because the reason is everyone sees the way, but they feel that, they think that what they see is the right one, right? And they fail to understand that it is not true, right? So this knowledge is being presented to explain the concept of the mithya. And why is it important to know this? That basically helps me to not fall for what I see just right away, right? I should be careful. I should use my own judgment. I should know the nature of what I'm seeing before I react. Otherwise, what happens? Something I see and immediately I will react, right? But then for once we know that it's mithya, it's the nature, that it is ever changing, and like why it is like that, then like we will be able to appreciate, or like we will stop reacting in the wrong ways, right? So this is how mithya concept is introduced. So then like the focus shifts to satya, right? So the point is like if something is there that is never changing, it is there all the time, then like where is it, what is it, like can I see, right? And like how do you describe it? So if you are saying that everything that my eyes are seeing, everything is mithya, then like And but if there is satya, then what is it? And like can I see it? Can I experience it? Right? Can that be defined? Right? That is the natural next question, which is where we are presented, like how or like what is the nature? Right? This is where the Atman is being introduced, saying that is the Atman, right? And what is the nature of the Atman? Right? The Atman basically is there, existence, right? And that is the Atman that gives the consciousness, and is there present everywhere, right? If there is some truth, the truth has to be present everywhere. It cannot be that like the truth is here and not there, right? So it has to be everywhere, so that is what is being referred to as the Sat Chit Ananda, right? So this is how the Atman is being introduced in this topic, right? And then like the question is about like, how do I realize this Atman? Where is the Atman? If it is there everywhere, why cannot I see it, right? And like, how do I see it? So for that question, the way Vedanta teaches us is through a subjective or a higher logic, right? The way Vedanta does that is, in general, in the world, in the real world, to get something, you have to do something, you have to go somewhere, right? But that is for something which is outside, right? Which you don't have it. Then like you have to go do it and get it. And whatever you get it, you can always lose it, right? But what we are talking about is this Atman, which we are saying is there everywhere, then it is there in me, right? Then how do we get it? So Vedanta teaches through recognition, saying that it is there. It is always there with you. You just have to recognize it. It's not something you have to get it. That you have to get it and then hold it and like ensure that you don't lose it, right? It is there always. You just have to recognize it. How does it do that, right? So Vedanta basically uses three prakriyas to say that like you have it, right? And how you can recognize it. That those three prakriyas are Shariratraya Prakriya, Avasthatraya Prakriya, and Panchakosha Prakriya. So the next part of this chapter details into each of these three prakriyas. I will pause here and I would like to know how the flow is so far.
It's going really well, Saravananji. One question. So can you elaborate further on? So you said the essential nature of me is Sat, Chit, and Ananda. Can you go into what is Sat, what is Chit, and what is Ananda? And how do I know that? How do I realize that? And how do I understand it?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So taking myself as the example and trying to explain, right? The Atman, right? So the way it goes is, if I am the Atman, then like how do I realize it, right? So that is where the nature of the Atman is given, which is Sat, the existence, which is do you have a question of your existence? If somebody calls me, I don't have to think about that, right? I know that I am here. I know that there is no question about my existence. That comes from, that is the Sat nature of the Atman, right? And the same way when somebody says, calls me or like questions me, are you there? Like, I'm always there, right? There is nobody I have to go to ask, like, am I there, right? Am I conscious? That consciousness part is coming from the Atman, right? And the Ananda, next one, Ananda, right? So Ananda is the infinite or the bliss.
But one nature. Question before you go there. In the world, we also see, oh, this person has become unconscious. Or this person has lost his consciousness, you know, he's now mad. So does it mean that it is also something that, you know, you can lose? It appears like that, doesn't it?
So it is basically the expression. So the expression of that is not visible outside because of the body, from the body point of view, right? But how do I say that? When you are dealing with the body, right? So the what you get. If a person is unconscious, let's say that somebody has gone into coma, right? So are they, the consciousness is the consciousness not there? The consciousness is there, but from outside it is blocked by the body because of whatever the body going through, right? That's why, like, when they recover, when they come back, right, they may not know what happened, right? But it is that they just, that the consciousness will always be there, which is why, like, they will come back and say okay, and they will be able to continue, right? So what we are always dealing is with the body from outside, right? But inside as Atman, the consciousness is always there. It is whether we recognize that or not.
So are you saying that, you know, there is no way I can say whether you are conscious? The only thing I can ever say is I am conscious and I am there. Would yes. that be a correct statement?
I am conscious and I am there. Exactly. Yeah.
So I cannot truly say that, you know, you are conscious. Can I? Or am I making a wrong statement?
So the conscious, again, when somebody is saying, it becomes, it's a statement, I would say, from the mind. It you can never negate this consciousness. The moment you see any human being, okay, you can never negate the consciousness factor. The consciousness, without consciousness, that person will not be able to operate at all.
Yeah, but what if, you know, let's say you are just a computer program that is appearing on my screen and is you know, intelligent enough through whatever the programming to respond back. But ultimately, it's me who is becoming aware, who's coming to say, yeah, I know this. Yeah, I understand this. So the understanding or the ability to know, to be conscious, is not coming from you, but it is in me. So I am saying, yeah, I understand. Oh, so therefore the source from where this sound is coming must also be conscious. So therefore, can I say that, you know, I don't know for sure whether you are conscious or not. I can say for sure that I am conscious. Would that be a right statement?
See, the moment you bring a second person, right? It is the second person's instrument, sense organs, that are being used, right? To interpret the other person or the consciousness of the other person. So now, the moment you bring the second person, then it is the state of that person, right? Let's say you, and there is one more person, right? If what is true, then everyone should give the same answer, right? Now, right? So and then, like, you have to realize what instrument you are using to make that statement, right? You are going to use the instrument of your eyes and ears, your mind, then say that, okay, you are this, you are so and so. Okay, I would say question that. How are you sure that that instrument is perfect? Okay. And it can never be as perfect as the real source, which is what the Atman is there in everyone, right? And only by refining that instrument, you will be able to accurately recognize the Atman.
So am I recognizing the Atman in you, or am I recognizing that Atman in me? Who is the teaching for, and who's recognizing what?
So this is first, this is all from the subject point of view. Okay. When I am reading, or like when I am learning, it's from my point of view of like how to understand myself first. Okay. Once I understand myself clearly, then the next thing is about like, how do I see the world? And the world, when I say the world, all the people again in that, because they are all appearing in me, right? First, I need to know who am I, like what is my nature? Right. So right now it is in this chapter. Right now we are still in this subject mode, which is me.
Okay.
Understanding self. Right.
Okay. So therefore, I can say for sure I'm conscious, but I cannot say similarly for sure that you are conscious. You are appearing in me. But whatever I am interpreting, ultimately I am interpreting and I'm understanding whatever you are saying. If you were to be for now speaking in Russian, I may say, oh, this is incoherent. I don't know. You know, maybe this is just some sounds.
Mm-hmm.
So ultimately the knowing is only within me.
Correct. Yeah.
So therefore, would the statement that I am conscious, however, the object appearing in me, I'm attributing the quality of consciousness because it is also appearing within the field of the consciousness. So through inference, I can say that. Is that the right way to understand what we are discussing?
Again, I would say that you are talking about the consciousness of the appearance, the object, isn't it?
Yeah.
Okay. So you basically want to know if the nature of Atman is Sat, Chit and Ananda, everything, even the objects, even when I will put all the people also under objects, everything that I see, do they all have consciousness?
Yeah.
Right?
See, ultimately I am knowing I exist. There is no doubt about it.
There's no doubt about it.
Yeah. And because all these objects are appearing in my existence, in my field of consciousness,
yes,
I am attributing that, you know, they also exist. I don't know whether it's a book or not, but the existence part is what I'm attributing to as existence.
Hmm.
But it is still appearing within my field of consciousness.
Then I would put it this way. So I was talking from the self-subject point of view. Now, when you bring the object, okay, is everything conscious, right? So there, we'll start with a stone, right? Atman is there everywhere, right? So which means the stone also has it. Okay, and what are the characteristics of, like, how are we defining Atman? Like Sat, stone, is there, okay. The Sat property is clearly visible, right? Chit, is it conscious? Right. So this is where the way I see it is, it is the the body that each one of them have taken basically allows you to see whether all the properties of the Atman are seen or not, right? If you compare the stone with the plant, right, the plant is growing. So I can say that the plant body is showing both the sat and the chit. The consciousness is there, and so it's growing. While a stone is only showing the sat nature of it, right? Then now I bring the human being. So how do you say, like, is the human being showing all these things? Sat nature is clearly visible. Human being is like see, chit. The human being is like responding, reacting, right? So there is this consciousness acting. Ananda, is it there? So that is where the whole discussion is, that this is a special body where the bliss nature, Ananda nature of the Atman can be realized as well. Only thing is, only you know, if you know how to, then you can. Otherwise, you are still, if you have not tapped into that knowledge, then like each one of us is going, is still living at Sat Chit level only. Right? We will have to, so that is where that, to prove that it is possible, the deep sleep experience is given to say that, you know what, even if you disagree, here is the state. Have you experienced a deep sleep state? If yes, then you agree, then you can take that as the basis that you can get the bliss nature of the Atman through this body.
Yeah.
How's that?
Sure. Yeah, maybe we can go to the next one. But the question I'm asking is, can I ever say that something else is conscious? Can I ever say that something else is infinite? When you say that in everything is appearing in you, see, right now this image of that is me in asking all these questions is appearing in you. You don't know whether this image is a programmed logic, which is maybe a very good program, but it's still a program.
Actually, it is your consciousness only. You, it is the seer's consciousness only which gives life to everything else. The outside, whatever you're seeing outside, cannot give something to the seer. It is the seer is the source of how what is being seen, how you are interpreting, right? It is your own nature is what, your own interpretation is what you are seeing.
Excellent. So when I say stone is only existence, because the seer is not able to recognize the consciousness part.
Yes.
So it's only existence. Correct. Is more visible.
Correct. Yeah. It is, I would say it is the reflection of the seer is what how everything is getting interpreted.
So the object becomes the reflection of the seer's mind.
Mind, correct.
Very nice.
Yeah, outside the seer, nothing is giving life to what. There is nothing separate. If the seer closes the eye, it disappears. There is nothing, right? So the seer is it's all in the seer instrument and the mind that basically creates the whole scene.
No way to say that there is something outside the seer, because everything is in the field of the seer.
Yeah, correct.
Very nice, Saravanji.
Yeah, so this is how I have been like contemplating on this topic of like what is the flow, what am I trying to get from this, and like why these terms are being introduced, concepts are being introduced, right? Yeah, and like how it will help me by understanding this. Yeah, so once the term Atma was introduced, then the natural question is, if there is Atma, whose nature is so and so, is there something else outside Atma, right? And which is what then we call as Anatma, right? And the Atma and Anatma Viveka are introduced. Now the question is, okay. So now I got Satya, Satya and Mithya, right? Now you're saying there is Atma and now there is Anatma. So how do I put all these things together, right? So the way Atma is introduced is as the Sat Chit Ananda. And something is there everywhere all the time, but something that cannot be seen by the eyes, or like you cannot hear it, by the ears, you cannot define it in some way, right? Then what happens to all that I see? Everything else that we see is all Anatma. Basically, Atma is the one that gives life to each and everything, that gives that character to each and everything. What they are is the one that gives the nature of eyes to the eyes, right? That gives the nature of hearing to the ears, right? Without Atma, everything else is basically jada. They don't get their consciousness part of it. The eye is not going to have that function of seeing, or ear cannot see, hear it, right? So the way I see it is, all the things that we see, they have shown up in different forms and different ways, and it is that one Atman that is giving them all those forms, and with that chit part consciousness, they are all like this, bird or tree or stone or human being, right? So these are all like it is one Atman alone in like so many different forms, in different ways, right? So if you just take the body part, or like what you see, what you touch, then all that is all the Anatma part. I mean, this is how Atma and Anatma are being introduced.
Then from my viewpoint, essentially whatever appears is Anatma to me.
Yeah.
So yeah. Then shall I negate? Is that then it also means right now the picture of Saravananji talking and responding is also an experience. So it is Anatma.
So there is nothing that is there without Atma. Okay? It is just that you cannot see Atma as something different. Right? Atma is the one that is that you are, whatever you are seeing, basically Atma is behind that. Right? You cannot separate out the Atma and what you are seeing. Okay, what you are seeing is the Anatma, and the reason why you are seeing is the Atma behind it. Without Atma, that will not be there at all.
Yeah, right. That part is clear. But then it is not like there is Atma and there is another Atma.
No.
So therefore, whatever is appearing in, say, your field of consciousness is an experience, whatever it may be, isn't it? Which essentially, from a definition standpoint, whatever appears and disappears is anatma. Is that right?
Okay. So yeah, so let's say the moving part is the mithya part, right? That the for that motion we are saying, but like whatever the as the objects we see, right? If I take this computer, right? So it does not have a life of its own. That is what we are calling as the anatma part. If I take this body, the body does not have consciousness of its own, right? So what is behind this body that gives the consciousness to the body is the atma, right? And so when I see everyone, right? So I see the body, I understand that is the anatma part, which will change all the time, continuously. Today I see him or her are like this. Okay, tomorrow they will change. They were not like this before, but there is one unchanging behind them, which is powering them all the time, which is the Atman, which is the same as in the second person and in me.
But that there is a Atma in the second person is only because you are Atman, you are attributing that, because the second person is an object in your consciousness. The other person is only appearing in your field of consciousness.
Correct. Yeah.
The second person is not outside your field of consciousness.
Yes.
And the second person, it may be a person, it may be a book, it may be a bird, it may be a tree, it may be whatever may be the object. Whatever is appearing is in your field of consciousness.
Correct. Yes. Yes.
So it has to be anatma.
It has to be anatma. No. Yes. Yes.
It is mithya.
Yeah. Yeah. That's right. That's right. Yeah. So you can use this subject-object relationship, that I am the subject and everything else I see is the object, right? And I basically interpret what I see, irrespective of whatever I see, right? So since all the things that I see, they come and go, because I close my eyes, they are gone. I sleep, they are gone. But I am always there, because in my existence is what all that I am experiencing. So in that way, I am the only true self, Satya, right? And everything else outside me is all anatma, right? They come and go, it is, yeah.
Including the body that we experience. It also comes,
yes,
and goes.
Because that is changing all the time. Yes, yes. The nature, the very nature of the body is changing. So I sleep, I get up, it is different. It's going to be different. It is just that, like, how much I can see the changes. As I said, if somebody says, no, I have the same hand as last night or as yesterday, how are you saying? Because I see. You're using this eyes. How much this eyes can see the change, right? It has its own limitation. Any instrument has its limitations. When the change becomes bigger, then the eyes is able to show you. When you get a wrinkle, then you say, oh, I got old. It is just that eyes accuracy or depth is only that much, right? It cannot show the microscopic changes every minute. Every second, it only macro changes is what the eyes is able to see. Or if there is a cut, then like there is a change, right? Which is why we call that as the the anatma, right? It, or the anatma or mithya, it's changing all the time.
Very nice. So before we go into the prakriya part, Satya ji or Prakash ji, are there any questions that you want to raise to Saravanan ji? All right. So then we'll move on to the Atma Tattva Viveka. The...
Yeah. So, yeah. So trying to explain this concept of Atma, the Vedanta does it using three teachings, three prakriyas, which are the Shariratriya, Avastatriya, and Panchakosha Prakriya. Right. So we'll go there. Right. So when you take these Shariratriya Prakriya, right, so the way it starts is what we see ourselves is the body, and that's all we think, right? Are like we all agree that there is this body, but then we accept also that there is mind, which is somewhere. It's there is no question about it. So the body and the mind, there is no question about it. Everyone accepts it, right? So these two are introduced by Vedanta as the sthula sharira, the gross body, right? And then shukshma sharira, the mind, right? So there is no debate here, right? Where the third thing that Vedanta brings, which is not common knowledge outside, is the karana sharira, casual body, right? So
just one clarification there. Mapping the three bodies to the five koshas, from a five kosha standpoint, there is pranamaya, manomaya, vijnanamaya. The three together are referred as the sukshma sharira.
So I was planning to get to the panchakosha later.
Okay.
This is the mapping we will do.
Okay. Yeah. Please continue.
So, coming to the sthula sharira, right? We all see this body, right? And the natural question is, why is the body different for everyone? Why is one in black color and another in brown and white and different colors, right? Not like, oh, some is short, some is tall, some is like different shape, right? So when you go into all these things, there is, for everything, there is a reason, right? And the way Vedanta introduces this, body is the karma phala bhokta, right? Some have born with perfect body, some have born with like deficiencies, right? So there has to be something which explains why different human beings are seen in different ways, right? So that is the karma phala bhokta. We introduce it, right? And but this is not the real one. This is, body is still an object. It is not the subject, right? The subject is the Atman, right? Which is the same anytime, anywhere, like untainted, right? It doesn't matter who however one looks, but internally it is the Atman that is powering that, and it is same, right? And the nature of this body is like, it goes through changes all the time, right? It is born, it grows, and then like it matures, and then it starts decaying, and then it dies, right? That is the nature of this body. There is nothing you can contest about, right? So it is anitya, it is anatma, right? Only the for atma, whatever attributes you put, it's completely here, it's opposite, like it is born and so it will die, right? There it doesn't, it was never born, it is, there is no death, right? And here, like, it is always changing. There Atma, it, like, never changes, right? So so this is very important to know this nature of this body, because on the other side, if you go to the material world, you will see that the whole world is going after, like, maintaining that perfect body, trying to retain that youth body all the time. You go through all these advertisements and, like, all the things done. Knowing this nature of the body helps to know that, like, what it is and, like, where to focus on, right? The focus, this is how my interpretation and, like, how I am applying all this learning to myself, right? The focus is needed for a healthy body, where this body is used as a vehicle, right? There is a reason why each one is born, right? As I said, it's a karma phala bhokta. Now the point is, like, once you have this body, now how do I use it in the right way? So that is the whole concept of what we are going through, right? Yeah, so that is the nature of this stula sharira.
But again, connecting to the previous conversation we had, everything is appearing in the field of your field of consciousness. So therefore, even the birth and the death is happening based on in your field of consciousness only. There is no birth and death beyond you.
Yeah. So if one can operate from that point of view all the time, then I think all these discussions they will disappear. Very true. All these discussions still happening when I'm operating, when I'm seeing at the level of
there is separateness. This is separate, only separateness creates other body, this body and that body.
Yeah, I'm still talking from a point of view of how I introduce these concepts to a seeker or to a non-seeker, right? And explain, like, why it is and how it is true, what is the reality, right? And the next point is basically being able to operate from that point of understanding. Then, like, all these concepts are not needed at all then. Very true.
Very nice.
Okay, then we go to the Sukshma Sarira, right? So when you come to Sukshma Sarira, it is broadly people know it as mind, but then, like, it includes the sense organs, right? And the five Jnanendriyas and the Karmendriyas, the organs of the action. And the pancha prana, right? Prana, apana, udana, samana, dhyana, the mind and the intellect, right? The buddhi, right? So why is all this put together? Because the subtle body is actually is the experiencer of what the gross body goes to, like, experience. Like, the gross body, it is just a dumb instrument that keeps giving it, right? So you cut the body. It is actually the mind which feels the pain, right? Same with the eyes and ears. They just receive it as per the nature of the instrument. It is the mind that actually puts together and interprets what is being seen or what is being heard, right? So mind is at a little higher level than the body, right? So the focus, a lot of focus is given on this mind, because this is where the entire interpretation or ananda or dukkha, everything happens here. In this is the one that actually goes through all the things. right? All the experiences of a person is actually happening here, right? So, and in some ways, if one doesn't know the Atman, the mind basically is the center stage running the show. And this is why this knowledge is very important to understand. Is it that mind is not the real one, right? And if then, like, how can I control the mind? And like, how do I do that? Then who is the real one? That knowledge, you know, basically helps, right? Yeah. So that's the Sukshma Sarira. It basically also it's the place which basically even goes to, like, so this is the part where all our, again, impressions, vasanas are written, and this is the body that keeps moving from one to another as the gross body stula shrira drops, right? And and then the next thing is, can this mind then be...
Anyway, then you can say that, please tell me whether, you know, you think this is the right statement, and if so, why? So the moment you drop an idea and you adopt a new idea, you can say that, you know, you are reborn?
Almost.
From the standpoint of a body?
Almost. I was thinking sometime back, we celebrate birthdays where the body was born. Actually, there is a different birthday, I would say, where my mind is reborn, which is the day I joined this Vedanta class. So that is a kind of a birthday from a mind point of view for me, that, like, I'm reborn, where, like, there is, like, reprogramming happening, and based on that, like, how you live is very different.
Excellent. Very nice.
Right. Yeah. And so I'm maybe we'll skip through the part where, like, each and every
can you tell me where you want me to go?
From here, I want to go to Karana Sharira. Is that fine?
Yeah.
Right. So now that, like, we know that so mind is the happening place. Mind is the one, for software engineers, I call it the config file, where everything is written. Okay. And every time you load it again, it's going to new birth. It's going to read the config file and put it again. So now my point is, how do I refine this config file? Or, like, at the end of the day, I'm going to erase it. As long as something is there, I'm going to be born again to read it and, like, I'm going to go after it, right? Every vasana which is there is going to be there. Everything I have wrong ideas in life, it is going to be there until I correct them, right? And that is basically, that leads to the Karana Sharira, right? So that is the seed, right? Now it is written. Now the question is, like, how did it start even? Like, why, if there is only Atma there, like, and there is nobody else, then, like, who is going through all these things? And, like, why am I born? And where did it start? Can you tell me, like, how did it start? Where did it start? Right? So that is where the nature of this Karana Sharira, we go into. It's like the point that is attributed is ignorance, right? You can say that, like, it's difficult to describe, indescribable, anirvachaniyam, we say. And you cannot attribute any start to that anadi, right? But you can definitely say that there is going to be an end, right? The day you know it, that is the end of the ignorance, right? Very simple examples, day-to-day examples. Like, if you ask me, like, do I know German? I don't know German. Since when I don't know German? I don't know. It's always been like that. But do I know English? I know English. Since when? The day I started learning, I know English, right? So the same way, this ignorance due to which this is happening can and will end the day I understand this concept. I understand myself, right? So that is where this Karana Sharira is how it's explained. Is there something else I want to talk about Karana Sharira? Yeah, I think that should be fine. To put together, and this slide basically says, to put together, there is this ignorance of what I am, not knowing what I am, which leads to the feeling of the incompleteness that I want to be whatever I am, I don't have. Right, I want this, I want that, I would like to be this, I would like to be that, right? That the feeling of incompleteness, which feeds the desire, and the desire leads to the action, and every action we have to bear the fruit, and that's the cycle of karma continues, right? And why do we say that jnana can only burn this karma out? The jnana is the light that's going to turn the darkness away, right? So the only way you can remove darkness is by lighting, and that is the jnana that will basically throw light on the ignorance and tells one what is real and what should be the nature of the way you look at things. Right? So once we know this, right, almost Shariratra Prakriya itself, like if you take, it makes it very clear. And do I even need to go any further? You question, right? So it makes it very clear on the concepts. But then Vedanta continues to put it from different angles to convince or to explain the seeker. Yeah, we'll stop here again. Yeah.
Yeah.
Any questions or feedback so far of the floor?
No, I think from my viewpoint, Satyaji, Prakashji, anything else to ask? Okay.
No, Vijay.
Yes, I don't. Yeah. Okay. So the another prakriya that Vedanta takes is Avastatri prakriya, right? To again explain the same concept, that body, mind, the Atman concept, right?
But you just
so said, it takes the state. We all know that
Dehatraya prakriya itself negates. Has it really negated everything?
Has it negated everything in terms of?
So in terms of when I operate in the life, it has negated bodies.
So the body, Avastatraya Prakriya explains everything from the with the body, right? So
Dehatraya.
Dehatraya. Yeah. So yeah. That explains everything with the body, right? Now in Avastatraya is where Vedanta moves to explain that even that body, you exist without the body. So that is a new concept that is being brought here.
No, but why again Vedanta has brought another prakriya? If it has already negated everything, there is need to be negated. why there is a avastha traya and why, see that is called as a deha traya. This is avastha traya.
Yeah, yeah, that's what. So we say that like, sorry, we completed. Yeah.
Why is there a avastha traya?
Mm-hmm. Okay. So the reason is, we explained that this body is anitya, is and is anatma. You are not that body, right? Then the seeker wants to know, like, is there a way I can experience myself without the body? I think that's where the avastatriya prakriya comes in. Here you go. I will show you now. You actually experience. You go through times without the body. It is just that, like, you have not realized it, and it goes to explain it.
Very nice. So one is to help you realize that, you know, you are without the bodies. Yeah. Okay. Is there any other fundamental reason why avastatraya is necessary? Is it only again?
For and the there body? Is the second reason. Yeah. Yeah. Sure. So the second reason is we talked about the Satchit Ananda nature of the Atman, right? And we saw that, like, with the body, Sat and Chit is very clear, all the time is there. Ananda is like, this is where, like, things come and go, and like it just remains for a short time, and all the time we get it by something from outside, right? I feel happiness because of I did something, I got something, I ate something, right? And it remains for the short duration and it's gone. If the core of this existence is Atman and the nature is bliss, why am I not experiencing that bliss all the time? Or, like, is it there? Right? And that the nature of bliss can be explained through avastatriya prakriya.
Okay. So again, you are connecting it to explain the nature of the bliss.
Yes.
I'm asking the question from the standpoint of in the Dehatraya, the bodies have been negated.
Mm-mm.
What is that fundamental aspect that, you know, we are negating in the Avastatraya? Isn't there?
Isn't the world you see that, like, again, that comes and goes? Right. What do you see?
But if I make a statement such as,
mm-hmm,
we are bound by two fundamental conditionings. One is Desha, another one is Kala. Desha is nothing but the Dehas. Desha is always about the bodies, right?
And
the conditioned body by various bodies. Another one is there is a concept of a time in the mind. Time as something that, you know, continues to change. Yesterday, today, tomorrow. So can I say that avastatraya prakriya is negating the concept of the time?
So in the deep sleep, you basically get that experience of the absence of time. That is one. I would say that is one more way to explain that concept.
So can I say that, you know, to eliminate the Desha conditioning is the Dehatraya and the Panchakosha, and to eliminate the Kala concept is the Avastatraya. Would that be a right way to look at it, or would you modify that?
No. So this is so the way I interpreted, I saw this, right? Definitely in the Dehatraya, like, the three bodies are well defined, right? In Avastatraya, it's basically one is that with the explanation of the dream, very clearly the absence of mind thing is explained. And let's say you have a pain, right? It is there. But if it is real, it should be there all the time. And when you sleep, it is not there, right? and when you wake up, it's there again, right? So that to explain that is different from you, right? The avastatraya prakriya comes. Same way the bliss avastatraya prakriya comes, wherein like you get the experience. And the time, I will add the time as well. The absence of time, like it, you don't operate in time concept. That is also one experiences in the avastatraya prakriya. Maybe I would say like these three things are added in addition to what one gets from the Dehatraya.
Wonderful.
Is it right?
Yeah. So that's
what you are trying to add.
Yeah. So the fundamental. Why do we need another prakriya? If that prakriya was good enough.
Okay.
Why do we need another prakriya? I mean,
yes. What are the new things that are introduced?
Is there something else that you know it is clarifying?
Yes. So one is the absence of body, absence of time, and like complete aware of the bliss, experience of the bliss, right?
Excellent. Yeah.
Okay.
Because the fundamental question is, oh, I've never experienced Atman. You know, it's something like a journey. One day I will experience.
Mm.
When there is a question, Vedanta's answer is, it's evident. Let's look at it. Why is it evident that you have never really experienced anything apart from the Atman? Avastatraya takes us through that journey.
Yes. Correct. It's all towards that. Everything you are that. It is just that you don't recognize it. Here you go. I'm showing it to you. Now you tell me whether you agree or not. Right? So very, beautiful. Yeah.
All right. What do you want to take next?
Is that fine? Avastatraya. Yeah. So we will go through this concepts. I'll run through it. Yeah. So we all know that like we go through this three states when we are operating from the body point of view. There is a waking state where we are doing all the transactions, and then when we sleep, we go into a dream where we basically the new thing that Vedanta highlights is that you lose the body consciousness, right? From the point of the self, right? You can always say that the other person can say, oh, that is the body, but only when the other person, it's only from the other person's point of view. But when you are in the self, you basically get disconnected from the body, right? Which basically the absence of the body. So that means like you exist without the body, and that's the dream. And the deep sleep, you basically lose, drop the mind connection as well, right? Both body and mind are like awareness is not there. And when mind is not there, that is where the experience is being given for the bliss. And that basically says like, you don't need to go out to get something to eat and feel bliss, or to travel to some place to feel that bliss, right? If you can understand, connect this, that absence of mind leads to bliss, then like, can I drop the mind to get that bliss in the waking state? It will be the next question, right? The reason why I am doing all the other things is to feel that bliss, but then like my mind is always active all the time, right? So that's where we will see that like how the calming the mind, it's not about negating the mind, dropping the mind, right? It is the same mind that is being used to realize and to get the bliss in the waking state as well. That is the whole journey about, right? So as like I've seen in different places, they say that mind, it is like a monkey, a drunken monkey keeps jumping all the place, right? So it is a good servant, but not a master, good master, right? So, and the art is learn to control the mind and not force the mind again. Control the mind by knowing how it operates. Actually, that's where I found that Vedanta goes deep into the functioning of the mind scientifically and telling like how to use the mind, how to control the mind and use it by giving knowledge, because mind operates with the intellect, with the buddhi, right? So by actually giving the right information, the way how the mind operates can be manipulated, can be changed, right? So that like at the end you basically reach the state where the mind is convinced that you are complete, right? And you are like ever present. There is no birth, death, and as a result, what happens is you lose the desires, outside external desires, and you lose the fear of, okay, am I running out of time to accomplish something, or like get to their life, will this life will end before I will do something. So all those, that fear will go away, that once you realize that completeness of self, right? That's how it goes, right? So the manipulation of the mind. Yeah. So let me come back. So dream state and deep sleep state is where like you experience it, and these three characters are being introduced: Vishwan, Tejas, and Pragyan. For the three states, where like Vishwan has the one who has the body consciousness, and Tejasan is one who has dropped the body, has only the mind level, and Pragyan is where like the deep sleep without the body mind consciousness. And all these things, all these three states, which we easily can identify. Vedanta says that all these three states, the fact that it's a state, right? There is a background to all this, which is what is called the fourth, the Turiya, right? And that is the foundation on which these three states are coming and going. But the Turiyas, Turiya is the background which is there all the time. Which sees these states come and go.
Clarify one small point you made there, Saravananji. Jagrata, Swapna, Sushupta is from an individual standpoint. Vishwa, Taijasa, and Pragna is from a cosmic body standpoint.
Mm-hmm.
So when I am awake, I see the world, and the world is Vishwa.
Mm.
When I'm dreaming, I am in the Swapna Avastha, and the dream world is Taijasa.
Taijasa, okay.
So there is a, okay, me and the world, no?
Mm-hmm.
Me and the world. So therefore, that world also has been given
a name.
Name.
Okay. Yeah, okay, got it.
Yeah.
Let's
continue.
Yeah, so. So this is to, with Avastatraya Prakriya, we are also saying that one way I've seen is all these three states come and go. And so like not to give over importance to one state over the other, because all the three come and go, right? The point is to realize that Turiya, the foundation on which all these things come and go. right? So the samsara is because like we give way too much importance to the waking state and take everything very seriously. This is where the story, King Janaka's story is told, right? Where he goes into a dream and like he's going through a lot of misery, and then when he wakes up, he starts asking like, is this real or that real? And right, which very clearly, it's a nice one which tells you that like it is just that like we are giving right now the samsara is because I'm giving way too much importance to this waking state, right? And take it very seriously that I have to reach some levels. I see what I give importance, way too much importance to what I see, and the mind interprets the buildings as like very true, and want a big building, flashy cars, and the people with power. Right? It is just the way mind got used to it, and like if I start going after it, basically it is complete illusion, and like one will do this only when out of ignorance, and like not when you know what is the science behind it, right?
Yeah, that is why the deep sleep state is also, see, there are two names, prajna and avidya.
Yeah,
so the I am going to sleep, in the morning I'll wake up and I'll have to do my work, when that avidya is still there, when the ignorance is still there, that I am the body, that I am this mind, then it is the avidya rupa. Mm. Then it becomes, once when that avidya is removed through the jnana, it is the prajna rupa. So nothing changes from the world standpoint. Still the jnani will also sleep, eat, wake up, seem to be doing the worldly activities. But now that is the deep sleep is no more the state of the ignorance. It is a prajna rupa.
Yeah. Hmm. From a jnani point of view, it's avidya.
Yeah.
Yeah. From a jnani point of view, you're saying, from a jnani point of view, what do you say?
Now there is no more avidya, in the sense that
the jnani is aware of that state.
So the awareness is no more lost. Mm. It is now prajna. Mm.
Mm. Yeah. Okay. So that's about the avasatre prakriya.
Yeah.
And so then we move to the next.
Can we conclude in the next 5 minutes?
Or should we take this in the next class? Or
that's why I'm asking you.
We'll take it in the next class, so that I don't want to rush. I will take time.
Wonderful. All right.
I want the absence of time.
Very nice. Satyaji, are there any questions that you would like to bring up?
No, it's fine. I mean, Charananji has brought his understanding out very well, and your questions make us think more and do a lot of churning where the exact answer comes out.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right. So then we'll end our today's session. Okay, Prakash ji left. Saravanan ji, would you be please sing us through the closing prayers?
Right speaking. असतो मा सद्गमय तमसो मा ज्योतिर्गमय मृत्योर्मा अमृतं गमय। ॐ शांति शांति शांति। ॐ लीड मी फ्रॉम अनट्रूथ टू ट्रूथ डार्कनेस टू लाइट इम्परमानेंस टू परमानेंस। सेल्फ इज द होल। ॐ पूर्णमद पूर्णमिदं पूर्णात् पूर्णमुदच्यते पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते। ॐ शांति शांति शांति। ॐ दैट इज कंप्लीट दिस इज कंप्लीट। व्हेन कंप्लीटनेस इज रिमूव्ड फ्रॉम कंप्लीटनेस व्हाट रिमेन्स इज कंप्लीट। When completeness is added to completeness, totality remains complete. Om peace, peace, peace. Who am I? Nanu, nanenbadu, nanalla, ideha manabuddhi nanalla, sachidanandatma, shivananu nane, shivoham, shivoham, shivoham. I'm not the body, mind, intellect. I am pure consciousness, Shiva Swarupa. I am true self, his liberation. Atma darshanam, Brahma darshanam, Brahma darshanam, Satya darshanam. Recognition of self is recognition of the whole. Recognition of the whole is the truth. May all be free from suffering. Om Triambakam Yajamahe Sugandhim Pushtivardhanam Purvarkamiva Bandhanat Mrityor Mukshiyamamrita. Om Triambakam Yajamahe Sugandhim Pushtivardhanam Purvarkamiva Bandhanat मृत्योर मुक्षीयमामृतात्। ओम त्र्यंबकम् यजामहे सुगंधिम पुष्टिवर्धनम् पूर्वार्कमिव वंदनात् मृत्योर मुक्षीयमामृतात्। वी वर्शिप द थ्री आईड वन हु इज फ्रैग्रेंट एंड हु नरिशेस ऑल। लाइक द फ्रूट फॉल्स ऑफ फ्रॉम द बॉन्डेज ऑफ द स्टेम मे वी बी लिबरेटेड फ्रॉम डेथ फ्रॉम मोर्टैलिटी। लोका समस्ता सुखिनो भवन्तु। लोका समस्ता सुखिनो भवन्तु। लोका समस्ता सुखिनो भवन्तु। मे ऑल बीइंग्स बी हैप्पी हेल्थी एंड पीसफुल। हरि ओम।
थैंक यू वेरी मच शरण जी। थैंक यू वेरी मच। इट वाज वेरी वेल एक्सप्लेन्ड बाय यू। So very nice.
Yes.
So we'll continue and conclude in the next session before we take up the next Atmajyoti. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.